morning. Good morning. Welcome. I'm so glad to see everybody this morning. It's not just a privilege. It's just wonderful to be here. I was reading in Psalms this morning, Psalm 122, the very first verse says, "And with joy I heard them say, let us go worship the Lord. And here we are." And it's just wonderful. I'm so glad to see everybody this morning. A special welcome to our first-time visitors today. If you're here for the first time, we have a special gift for you out in the narthex at the welcome desk. And after the service, please stop by and pick that up. We'd like for you to have a bag with some information and some goodies. In each pew, there should be a red attendance pad. And we would ask if you would please just register your attendance in that. And then pass it down the pew so that other people can also sign it. And sometime during this week, Pastor Ellen, Pastor Clay, and myself will have an opportunity to read those and to pray over them. And if you have a special need or request, please write it on there, and we'll be glad to receive that. This morning, and I think I just dropped mine, but I don't need it for an example, because you all have one in each pew. There should be many big pink cards. This is our first Sunday of our stewardship time of year, our stewardship month, and this first Sunday we're focused on prayer. We're going to talk about our vows all for the next 5 weeks, our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, and we're going to begin with prayer this morning. And we'd just like to let you have this. And if there's a way that you feel that you could serve the church through prayer or more prayer, you can fill it out and put it in the offering plate if you wish. But I'd just suggest that you take it home with you and pray over it. Novel idea, but just take it and ask God to guide you in how you can more than support this church through your prayers, please. There are a lot of announcements in the bulletin. There are a lot of announcements in these announcements, the colored boxes there. This week is the last week. The Blue Bonnet Preschool is having their fundraising drive with Little Caesars pizza kits. So if you would like to participate in that, you can let them know in the front office during the week. Thursday, I think the 20th, is the last day for that. Today is the last day to sign up to go with us to the Rock Box Theater a week from Saturday. We're going to go, there's a tribute show to Waylon, Willie, and Johnny. And there's a lady in the church, I won't mention your name, who said, "Boy, I hope they don't mind if I sing along with every single song because I know them all." And I said, "There'll be a lot of us singing along with all the songs." So if you'd like, I have to finalize the ticket sales tomorrow. So if you'd like to go, there's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex. Please sign up when the service is over. A calendar of events on the back. There's a lot of things happening in the church, and this is the season when we begin to have, it seems like, extra committee meetings in anticipation of our annual church conference coming up next month. Of particular importance is this week on Wednesday evening. The nominations committee is meeting to help select leadership for the upcoming year. Neat thing about the nominations committee is they only meet about once or twice a year in the fall. But if you're on that committee, now's the time when you need to meet, and we'll be thankful for you. And an interesting side note, Pastor Clay is not with us this morning. We have sent him on a mission trip today. He has preaching this morning at Fuzzy's Corner. Actually, the Highland Lakes United Methodist Church, located at Fuzzy's Corner. But his service started a half an hour ago, but he's filling in out there this morning, so our best prayers are for Pastor Clay and those folks. Well, that's about all that I have. Are we ready? Let's worship.
All the glory.
Amen. Thank you all. Would you please stand if you can and join me in our opening prayer this morning. We pray together, God of our hearts, we've come with thirsty hearts, praying that your word will satisfy us. We come with aching hearts, praying for good news to comfort us. We come with overflowing hearts, praying for a chance to share your love. You who know our hearts and hear our prayers, be with us now in this hour of worship. Amen. And I invite you now to greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ and pass the peace. Invite you to be seated and invite at this time our children to come down front along with Miss Sarah, and it's time for our children's sermon.
Good morning. It's so glad to have all of you here. So is school going okay? You still like school, most of you? I hope you're not tired of it, because you have a ways to go. We're in what? Are we 6 weeks in? 4 weeks? 4 weeks? Okay, I kind of lost count. So this morning I have a question for you. Has anyone ever seen this slogan anywhere? Anybody?
Oh, yes.
What slogan is it?
It's Nike's.
It's Nike's slogan.
I've seen it on a shirt.
You've seen it on a shirt before?
Yes.
Let's see if you're right. Yeah, you're right. It's Nike. So Nike's slogan was, just do it. But did you know when Nike first started, they only had running shoes? All they had was running shoes. You didn't know that? I didn't either until I did some research. So then they decided that they wanted to do other things. So they started making basketball shoes and soccer shoes and all different kinds of shoes and backpacks. And so today you can find just about any type of shoe in the Nike store. So they've went from just having running shoes where you can buy all different kinds of shoes. It doesn't really matter. They can sell almost anything. Isn't that a lot of shoes? A lot of shoes, isn't it, really? So today, this kind of reminds me of our Bible story. Because Nike's slogan is just do it. And they came up with that slogan because people, they don't want people to just wear their shoes. Because if they wear their shoes and they really don't do much with the shoes, it doesn't help. Because if you have basketball shoes, but you don't play basketball, is that a little strange, maybe? So you need the shoes, but then you also need to do something with the shoes. So that's why they came up with the slogan, just do it. Just go play basketball. Just go play football. Just go play soccer. Just go work out. Don't just wear our shoes, but do something with the shoes. So our Bible story today is about prayer. And God kind of had the same concept when it came to prayer. He prayed with his disciples. Does anyone know the first prayer that he had with his disciples? We say it in church a lot. The Lord's Prayer. What were you saying?
Our God who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And deliver us from temptation. No, deliver us from evil, for thy is the kingdom and the power for the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Very good. Great. I'm so proud of you guys. That's a long prayer to memorize. So I'm so glad that you know that prayer, because that was the first prayer that Jesus prayed with his disciples. And do you know what? He said, don't think about it. When you pray, you don't necessarily have to. If you're at a point where you can't bow your head, like you're driving down the highway or close your eyes, just pray. Don't think about it. Just do it. If someone asks you to pray for them, don't say, well, that's nice. Maybe we should pray for this person. Or maybe we should pray for that person. Or probably pray for that person later. Jesus said, no. You stop whatever you were doing and you just pray right then. And that's what he meant and Nike meant by just do it. Don't think about it. Just pray. Because lots of people need our prayers, don't they? And if we waited for the right time, we might miss an opportunity. Because how do we talk to God? What's our number one way to talk to God?
Pray.
So that's how we talk to God. So you know what? We're going to stop right now, and we're going to stop talking about it, and we're going to pray.
Dear Lord,
thank you for loving us.
Help us this week
to pray for everyone around us.
Like you have told us we need to do.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
What do we say?
Amen, Jesus.
Where, Miss Donna? We have a stewardship moment this morning, and Donna Mine, who most all of us know, is so graciously offered to do this. We're praying for you.
Thank you. I need them. Prayer. What is prayer? Dictionary.com. You know, we don't go to open a book. We go online. Says, prayer is a devout petition to God, a spiritual communion with God, the act or practice of praying to God. Well, Clay last week sure hit the nail on the head when his sermon on blessings. No, not jalapeno popper blessings, but the blessings that we give and get from each other. One of the best blessings is prayer. When we lift each other up in prayer, we're showing God's love to each and every one of us. One of the things that I do is Kairos ministry. And after a weekend, the offenders are able to come together once a week and pray in small groups with each other. This is the only chance they have to pray and to share what's going on with them that they want to ask for prayer for. They also have the opportunity to write those prayers down, and we as volunteers have the opportunity to send out by email these prayers to the rest of our volunteers to pray for them. It's a large community. It's a lot of prayer. As we walk our daily life, there's many obstacles in our paths, and there are a lot of joys. And what a blessing it is for us to have each other to share, to reach out and say, I'm struggling, sick, I received bad news, I lost my job, I'm having financial problems, please pray for me. Or we have a new baby, or my son, or my grandson, or granddaughter is graduating from college. Or hey, I'm having the opportunity to meet some friends I haven't been with for a long time. Please pray that it all goes well. As all of you know, I've raised Kinley for many years and been very blessed by this whole church family who has taught her what love is and what God is all about. Well, one weekend, she was getting ready for a concert, and they were at rehearsal, and one of the little girls just couldn't do it. She was antsy, she was all over, she was aggravating others. And I was sitting next to Kinley, and she leaned over to me, and she says, Mimi, we need to pray for her. And I said, well, all right, Kinley, you pray for her. And she did. She prayed for the little girl to feel his peace and his calm. Even our children have the best ability to pray. This church family is so blessed to be packed full of prayer warriors. One phone call leads to another phone call, one conversation leads to another conversation, an email goes out, and the prayers are going like crazy. We and our family have been able to experience that with Patrick. When everybody found out what had happened with Patrick, the prayer warriors started praying, not only here, but from friends of ours in LaPorte, Missouri City, all of them prayer warriors. We can reach out all over the place. And it worked, and it gave him peace, and he knew that he was loved. But think about how we can bless others in our community. When we drive in our neighborhood or we're walking down the street, just say a little prayer for the person in that house. Or when the school starts and the teachers and the staff and the kids are all involved, pray for them all. Say a prayer for them. That ambulance or fire truck that goes by, pray for those first responders and the people that are being served by them. When we go out to eat with our family, we always say a prayer before eating. And at the end of the prayer, our grandkids always go, Yay, Jesus! Do you ever stop and think of how many people those two words touch? That little prayer, Yay, Jesus. We can't help but thank God for giving us the blessing of prayer and listening always when we lift those prayers up. Matthew 11:22-25 says, Have faith in God. Jesus answered, Truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, Go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you and your sins. We're an awesome awesome church. We're an awesome prayer church. And God has blessed us all. Can we pray? Dear God, open our ears to listen. Listen for the times we can come to you in prayer every day in every way for everyone. We can talk to you and share our love for others. You hear us. You see the struggles in those around us and the joys. And you receive these prayers from all of your people. Thank you, God, for listening. Amen.
Thank you, Dawn. Thank you so much. As the ushers come forward to receive our morning offering, would you pray with me? Almighty God, you created us. You created all we are, all we have, all we ever will be. And Father, we just come now to say thank you, to return to you our tithes, our offerings, a portion of the wonders that you give to us. Bless now these offerings to your service, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all. Amen. Thank you. Would you stand as you're able and join with me in the doxology? Please be seated. It was brought to my attention before service started early this morning that last Sunday was Grandparents' Day. It's not that I didn't know about it, but what about my kids and grandkids? There's going to be some telephone calls when I get home today. No, just all in fun. But as we continue with our deep thoughts about prayer this morning, I invite you to watch this short video of grandparents.
Dear Lord and Creator of all,
as I watch my grandchildren grow, I pray to you to protect them from any danger.
Watch over them so they never know want or hunger. And thank you for the blessings of love, life, and their daily meals.
Guide their actions so they get along with all persons they meet in their journey.
Guide their actions so they are courteous and friendly. Instill in them a desire to learn so they can be informed and help others.
When they grieve, whether for a pet or any member of the human family, help them know that death and dying is part of our life.
I thank you for their lives and for the blessings they bring to me daily. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm sure glad to be back with you today. Last week was an unpleasant experience with a stomach virus that's on Sunday morning wasn't much fun. But my hat's off to Clay and Tommy for just stepping up and taking care of things along with all the rest of the staff. So as we do our prayer this morning, we're going to do things a little bit differently. I will offer the prayer and then we'll have a special version of the Lord's Prayer. Won't you pray with me? Loving and mighty God, we thank you so much for this day, for all who are gathered here. We ask, O God, that you be with those who are not here for whatever reason, that you will watch over them, that you will keep them safe, that you will protect them and bring them back to be with us, because we are not complete without all of the body. Today, O God, we ask that you be with those who serve in our military all over the world. Be with our first responders who come to our aid in life's most difficult and traumatic times. We pray for those who've been victims of storms on the East Coast and in other parts of the country. As Florence moves through the eastern seaboard, we thank you, O God, for the life-giving rain that you brought to our area. What a blessing. We thank you, O God, that there wasn't flooding, but there was good rain that nourishes our streams, our tanks, our animals, our grasses, our trees. Thank you, O God. We ask, O God, that you be with those who struggle under the weight of addiction. That you give them the strength, O God, that they don't feel they have to deal with their battle on a daily basis. For those who struggle with chronic illness and pain, place your healing hand, your comforting spirit upon them. For one of our own this morning who fainted during worship at early service, Lord, watch over him. We pray for those who struggle under the weight of depression or mental illness. It is a battle, and one so few understand. Help us to be compassionate and loving in all that we do. And now we pause and lift up those things that are on our hearts this day. God, listen to your children praying and trusting in you. We thank you, O God, that you are always present, that you are God. Help us to remember that we can go to you anytime, day or night, with whatever is on our hearts. In your name we pray. Amen.
Definitely a hard act to follow. Our scripture today is from Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 13, and it can be found on page 72 of our Pew Bible. He was praying in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial.' And he said to them, 'Suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him." And he answers from within, "Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything." I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds, and for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will you give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks, Chris. Yeah, you had a hard act to follow for sure. Thank you for giving me a minute to compose myself. Friends, won't you pray with me? Oh God, thank you for Mike, for his gift that you have given him that he uses. Thank you for Chris. Thank you for our choir. Thank you for all who give of themselves. Thank you for those who volunteer in silent, unseeing ways. All are a form of worship, O God. We thank you for that. And now as we open your word, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, because you, O God, are our strength, our deliverer. Amen. Remember back in the day, when cell phones weren't the norm. I know you younger people just kind of hang tough with me. There was a time when they didn't exist. Or they were mounted in our cars, or they were in a bag. Remember before iPads, computers. And we used those things so frequently, like momentarily. It's almost something we need to fast from time to time. And yet, our jobs depend on them. Our family structure depends on them. We are so accustomed to an automated world. And everyone has an app. And they want you to download their app and do your business on the app. And that bugs me, I gotta tell you. A couple times recently, I've gone into a place of business and said, I need such and such. And the employee looks at me very seriously and says, you'll have to go online to get that. And I want to say, do you realize you're killing your own job? Because at some point, that's what everybody's going to do, is just go online and we won't have need for you. But that is the world we live in. It is automated. Everything is structured. I grew up in a retail business, and it drives me crazy not to take care of customers. But that is where we are in this world. Do y'all like automation?
No.
Press one for this. Press two for that. I hate that. I just got to tell you. But I'll get off my soapbox. All of that is couched in a way that it is convenient, and it's wonderful until something malfunctions. Nita, would you help us?
The cross circuit in the food arachicycle.
Lumpy tea?
Oh, you've got some of the oatmeal fallout. How's your bacon?
Raw.
And your eggs?
They're cold. I don't get it. When we first got married, you could punch out a breakfast like Mother used to make. Now you're all thumbs.
It's not my thumbs, and it's not me. It's this antique monster. I press this thing for meals, and hi-fi music comes out of the garbage disposal. I never know what's going to come out. See, George, we need a new one.
Jane, how can we get a new one? We haven't even paid for the one that replaced this one. Besides, I'm beginning to like my coffee with lumps in it.
Well, I don't. I want a new food arachicycle.
A new food arachicycle? Jane, we cannot afford it. No. Absolutely, positively, emphatically, beyond the shadow of a doubt, and oh no!
George, are you trying to tell me something?
Forget it!
Why don't you ask your boss, Mr. Spacely, for a raise?
Because the boss is a penny-pinching old crab, that's why. That door is shut right in its electric eye. Pow!
Oh, I shouldn't have upset George. But if he only knew how I hate washing, ironing, vacuuming. There ought to be some higher authority a girl could appeal to.
You think there is?
Yes.
Everything was automated. That was one of my favorite cartoons as a kid. All those buttons they pushed. Everything looked so easy. She wishes for that higher authority. And we have one in our life every moment of every day. Those things that we want all the time. Those things that we need all the time. And so this morning I want to ask you a question, and I want to encourage you not to answer right now, but to think about it in the coming days. Do we, like Jane, wait until we get an emphatic no before we go to God? Do we wait until the door slams shut on us before we fall on our knees? Is God the last person that we consult about our lives? Think on that. Have you ever done something so routinely that you forget almost that you did it? One of my favorites is I always forget whether I locked my car. And so a lot of times you'll look in my office and you'll see me with my fob pointing out to the parking lot and listening to see if the horn honks or if I can see the headlights flash. Because I get out and I know I did it, but did I lock my car? You know, it's one of those things. It's as automated and routine as brushing your teeth, tying your shoes, all those things that we just do routinely, taking medication, putting on our seatbelt. And yet, we don't want things to become routine, not everything. We don't want to pray in such a way that it is so rote we don't even hear what we're saying. We don't even really feel what we're saying. We want things to be thoughtful. I don't want autopilot to take over all the time. I don't want a self-driving car, do you? And I sure don't want to encounter one on the road. That doesn't work out so well some of the time. You know, a spouse can quickly tell if you say, I love you, versus I love you. Right? It's very automated. It's just routine. A child can tell. If you say, how was your day today? Versus, how was your day? It's not just the tone. It's the difference in your heart. And if you're really thinking and you're really concerned and you really want to know, our God is that way. How dare we try to talk to God and stare at our cell phone at the same time? And yet we do. At least figuratively. We do it all the time when we're talking to our friends. Friends, when we are praying, it's serious business. It's kingdom work. It is so much larger than ourselves, and God deserves our full attention. And isn't it amazing that we think that God, the one who created us and knows us better than anyone, hasn't caught on to our disingenuous efforts at prayer? Come on. He knows our mind isn't on it. He knows we're focused elsewhere. Isn't it crazy that we can recite the Lord's Prayer in such a rote manner without making any effort, without really connecting to God, but we do it out of habit, we do it out of obligation? What if Mike could sing it for us every week? Would that not be the best ever? Oh my goodness. Brothers and sisters, like Jane Jetson, we just want a button to push and automatically connect with God in a way that's really not heartfelt, that's really not spirit-felt. We want a connection with God without the busyness of a relationship. We don't want to be bothered with that. We just want to give Him what we want and expect Him to respond and answer all of our requests. You know, God's not an order taker. And yet so often, that's the way we treat God. In our lesson this morning, Jesus encourages the disciples to remain connected through prayer. He encourages us to to remain connected through the giver of life. You see, Jesus promised to stay plugged into the Holy Spirit. He promised to give us the Holy Spirit so that we could remain connected. And he gives that great example of the neighbor who, even though he settled in for the night, would get up and share loaves of bread if asked. And there's a whole lot of background to that about how they slept in one big room and their children were all in bed with them and their animals were all in the room, and it was a huge issue to get up and to disturb all of that. And if the neighbor will get up and be disturbed and give you what you need, how much more will God? If we ask in a heartfelt, connected way. Again, God is not an order taker. He wants to hear from us. He longs for us to come to him and share our thoughts and our worries and our concerns. In verse 9, Luke describes the ways in which we can go to God through prayer, asking for our needs to be met. And again, notice he didn't say wants. He said needs. Don't we all have a want list? He said needs, not wants. There's a big difference. And that's not what prayer is about, to say, God, I need this and this and this. And oh, by the way, could you take care of this and this? It's about genuine communication. It's about sharing our hearts, ourselves with God. Truly plugging our hearts in. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, as we do in worship, so often it is sort of rote, because we're just moving through to get to the next thing. What if we said it with feeling? Set it in our hearts in a genuine way, in an intentional way, because the Lord's Prayer is a roadmap for us to experience the ways in which we can be regularly connected to God every moment of every day. As Jesus said in this lesson, all we have to do is ask. God wants to connect with us. He's waiting for us to connect. And yet, why do we fail to do so? He wants to know what's on our hearts. God also wants us to take the time to focus on something other than ourselves. Because unfortunately, we become a pretty self-arrogant, self-focused group. That's the way our culture is today. Our egos are stroked. We spend lots of times, consciously or otherwise, thinking about ourselves, our needs, our wants, our desires, our plans. We humans tend to be a pretty self-centered lot. Too often we live our lives like the commander who dreamed forever that he would be given the commission of the greatest battleship in the Navy. He wanted to be in charge of that wonderful ship, and finally he achieved that commission. It was the most grand battleship, and one stormy night as it plowed through the waters, the captain was on duty, and off the port side, he saw a light flashing in the distance. And so he asked the signalman to send a message to the unidentified craft. Alter your course 10 degrees to the south. Only a moment paused before the reply came. Alter your course 10 degrees to the north. Uh-oh, it was a standoff. Being the self-centered new commander that he was, and determined that his ship would take back seat to no other, he once again had the signalman send the command. Alter your course 10 degrees. I am the captain. The response beamed back. Alter your course. I am the lighthouse. I know some of you have heard that story and it's familiar to you. But it reminds me of our own self-centeredness and our arrogance, that the world revolves around us. And we risk being pretty arrogant and sure of ourselves. This morning in our pews, you'll find this pink card. And they're there for a reason. Don't push it aside. It's there for you. If you truly intend to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, that involves prayer. And that involves a commitment to prayer. I want to say a word about this. I wasn't clear at the first service, but there's a place on the top that you can fold it and put down what you've committed to pray for and put that in your billfold or your wallet so you remember. These things down here are a little different this year. It's very creative. We've thought of some different things, But you'll notice on the bottom, there's also an other opportunity. If there's something there that we're not putting, please add it, okay? This is for you. You're not making a commitment to your church. You're making a commitment for you to be faithful, for you to be connected to God. This is part of our stewardship sermon series. That's hard to say. Prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. We had to start with prayers. Prayer comes first in everything. So let me encourage you, if you want to fill this out, you may have already put it in the plate. If you want to bring it to the rail and put it on the rail, that's fine. But let me encourage you, you might want to take this thing home and pray over it. And bring it back later. Bring it back next week or one day this week if you're out and about. Take the opportunity to use this card to help you recommit as you joined this church and you said, I will support this church with my prayers. Again, you're not really doing it for the church. You're doing it for yourself. And you're doing it as an exercise to get reconnected with God. Brothers and sisters, if you've ever been through something really serious, really scary, you know how important prayer is. I know this morning singing that anthem was hard for Jeanette. She's been through the life journey of cancer with two of her children. I went through the journey of cancer, and you prayed me through it. And it's funny, I encounter people all the time, and I don't even know them. And I'll introduce myself in some setting. It may be at the gas station. It may be at the community center. It may be HEB, and they say, oh, Ellen, I know your name. I prayed for you. Wow, how humbling is that? And then you say, wow, thank you. That must be why I'm okay. You see what I mean? Prayer is such a powerful tool, and you've all been through something difficult. Maybe you lost your job. Maybe your marriage fell apart. Maybe you had a financial challenge. Maybe you battled the cancer demon or some other serious illness. Prayer is what undergirds everything that we do. And once again, I want to thank you for praying for me through that nightmare of our lives and praying for Wade. Prayer is the most wonderful, most powerful gift you can give to those that you love. And when you do so, you are sharing in God's kingdom work. Isn't that awesome? To be able to have a piece of that and to have a responsibility for that. And guess what? You don't need an iPhone. You don't need internet. You don't need an iPad. You don't need a computer. You need a heart that stills before God. You need a moment to fall on your knees. Maybe you do a devotional every day. If you haven't seen today's Upper Room, check it out. It's about prayer and the power of prayer in this woman's life. As she talked about homeschooling her children, I thought about Sally Best and all her children and all that she does and all that she juggles. Friends, all you need is a genuine heart and a trusting spirit, knowing that God will be with you. Do whatever you need to do to develop that prayer relationship with God. Your faith will grow. And your heart will explode with the love that God has shared you for you. And your life will be forever changed. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Won't you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, thank you for the opportunity that we have to share our hearts with you. To share all that we are and all that we have. Thank you, oh God, that you care. Thank you that you want to listen to our things that are on our hearts, the things that keep us awake at night. Thank you for loving us that much and for always being available, whether it's 2 a.m. or 2 p.m. Help us, oh God, be faithful to pray and to come to you, seeking earnestly your guidance, your will for our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn today, our hymn of discipleship, is Standing in the Need of Prayer. I need prayer. How about you? It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord. If there are those who would unite with our church family, we would invite you to come up as we sing this song. If there are those who would like to come to the prayer rail, maybe you were in awe of Mike and you just couldn't come down in the middle of that. Maybe you'd like to bring your card. That's fine. Know that this is an opportunity for you to do that. Won't you be standing as we sing? Thank you, friends. I wanted you to be seated so that you can see Paul and Elsie Jardine, who come to join our church family. What did I do?
The right name.
Well, you told me how to pronounce it.
I know it, but...
Okay. We're glad that you're here. We're excited to welcome you. And as my pastor used to say when I was a little girl, to extend the right hand of Christian fellowship. Do y'all remember that? Yeah, I remember those days. And so I have two questions for you. As members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Members of the household of God, I commend these friends to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Won't you join me? We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our commitment in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Did you hear that? They just reaffirmed their commitment. They did. You heard that. I have a witness. Okay. All right. Well, I'm so glad to receive you, and so I give you this greeting. The God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. I know that you'll want to come and meet them and get to know them, and I hope you have your name tags on. Some of you do and some of you don't, but you can come and greet them following the service and wish them a happy birthday, because they both have birthdays this week as well. No, not shame on me. That's part of being in the family. You're in the family. Brothers and sisters, won't you stand for the benediction? I was in a meeting this week and we talked about 9/11. And someone there was talking about, until 9/11, the word terrorist wasn't in the dictionary. It wasn't a word people talked about. And he was working in a school for the deaf, And he talked about the ASL symbol became this, the falling of the towers. Brothers and sisters, we don't have to have a 9/11 to remember to go to God in prayer, but this week we're all remembering 9/11 17 years ago. We have a lot to pray for. Our world has changed a lot, but you know what hasn't changed? God is still on the throne, and he's going to be on the throne no matter what, from now until that time when we are greeted in heaven one day. I'm thankful for that, and when I'm thankful, I say, thanks be to God.